что ж, доброе утро, дамы и господа.
Good, so я хочу поблагодарить организаторов этой конференции за
I would like to thank the organizers of this conference for the opportunity to talk on behalf of Covens, and also I am very happy to visit this wonderful city once again. Thank you.
I have been asked by the organizers of this conference to speak a little bit about how endpoints in clinical trial design is changing and following actually the evolution and improvements in cancer therapy. I just need to emphasize that I'm not a statistician, I'm a medical doctor, so this is really and solely a very independent physician's view of how the clinical trial designs and endpoints are changing to follow the improvements in cancer therapy. So obviously, clinical trials nowadays, when compared with the clinical trial design in the past, have changed a lot and are changing dramatically because there are so many factors that are playing an important role. It's first of all the improvements in clinical research itself by biomarkers development, discoveries of new pathways, immune modulating molecules, which are all actually really directing into a kind of personalized approach. But then also regulatory requirements for approving new drugs based on different endpoint criteria. Pharmaceutical companies who really try to have short and less costly ways to get their drug on the market. And then, of course, patients who are all seeking to get the best treatment for their treatment. So actually, we all faced, of course, different treatment paradigms that have been in the past, let's say 60, 70 years, from chemotherapy through discovery of targeted compounds, and now really going into the new era of immunomodulating drugs, and of course how the effects of these treatments have been measured to actually see what was the clinical effect of the patients, from WH criteria through RECIST and RECIST 1.1 and immune response, immune-related response criteria, though I need to make a little observation that actually some of the registrations of the immunomodulating drugs have been basically made on using the RECIST criteria, but we have to emphasize the importance of immune-related response criteria, who really try to recognize the universal effect of immune-modulating drugs on the host and not really on the tumor. So obviously, all the improvements and molecular discoveries that are or are being made and will be made really emphasize the need that the design of clinical trials needs to change, and that we cannot go with clinical trials with hundreds and thousands of patients, because actually these patients do not have all the same tumors. Important is to recognize also the companion diagnostics, so it's really a parallel drug diagnostic development, and let me just emphasize that it goes back to 98 with the development of Herceptin and immunohistochemistry assay, which were approved by FDA in 98, and later on pertuzumab, cetuximab, just to name a few of them. So the companion diagnostics are really very important because they direct into a personalized approach, and both FDA and EMEA have their guidance is to identify patients who can mostly really benefit from the treatment, also to identify those patients who can, who have more chances for toxicity, but also to follow the response of the patients when treated with the specific drug that is targeting the specific pathway, and eventually maybe to modify the treatment. So just quickly to go through some major discoveries in the chemotherapy history, going back to almost 70 years ago with nitrogen mustard, then really improvements in treating leukemias, approval of Taxol mid-90s for advanced ovarian cancer, then trastuzumab approvals. On the example of non-small cell lung cancer in 95, the platinum-based treatments for advanced non-small cell cancer, then erlotinib approval for second-line cancer, crizotinib approval for patients with ALK-positive rearrangements, and then, of course, going into the era of immuno-oncology compounds, which Professor Egermont already explained, and just to say that now we are already in the development and research of the third line, third generation immunomodulating drugs. So actually tremendous approvals have been made in the oncology development. So how the endpoints have been changing and how actually the clinical trial design is going to change or is already changing and trying to make it more focused and more patient orientated. So endpoints are really very important because based on the endpoints, we have to guide the clinical trial design, the sample size, the power, which will really then answer whether one drug is beneficial for a patient or for a certain number of patients, can the drug be approved or not. And it's really crucial to have a correct regulatory and statistical design approach, not to approve a drug that is not beneficial or to really miss the drug that is effective. So we have to understand how the drugs work, which patients are really most beneficial, and how to match the statistics, the clinical research, and the medical knowledge. So basically, clinic endpoints need to be valid, reproducible. They need to be also clinically meaningful, because an endpoint for an advanced disease is not the same as an endpoint for patients who are in adjuvant setting. Of course, the primary goal of all the trials would be, in an ideal world, to prolong the survival, to improve the quality of life, to have very limited toxicity, and of course, to bring the best benefit for the patient. And here on this slide is just a short overview to see how certain drugs, this is a presentation from the FDA overview, which drugs which clinical trials actually used which endpoints. So you can see that basically a lot of trials used surrogate endpoints when approving certain drugs. Some used overall survival, for example, bevacizumab for second line colorectal cancer, or docetaxel in gastric cancer, but for in progression-free survival was used for approving gemcitabine in second line ovarian cancer, or pemetrexed for non-small cell cancer, lung cancer. So obviously the clinical trials and endpoints are different. Overall survival is really the most robust and the only unambiguous endpoint, but there are certain challenges with overall survival because it really requires a long number of a big number of patients to detect a small difference. They can be biased by post-progression treatment. They can also be biased by crossover, which we see in many trials. But of course, overall survival can be a quite meaningful endpoint, maybe in more aggressive and more advanced stages of disease where patients really are exposed to, or have been exposed to all treatments, that they don't have anymore any kind of treatment options, and then they give a last trial, the try in a clinical trial. Maybe I can just give an example of metastatic colorectal cancer and approval of regorafenib. So what are surrogate endpoints? These have been defined 30 years ago by Prentice, who says that actually surrogate endpoints have to have the same effect of the intervention and to have it translated in the same clinical effect like for the primary endpoint. And different surrogate endpoints can be used, excuse me, surrogate endpoints can be used. First of all, progression-free survival, I will cover a little bit more, as the most commonly used. Then in adjuvant setting, it's more, oh, I'm sorry. In adjuvant setting is disease-free survival, objective response rate, which is maybe more applicable for cytostatic than for cytotoxic drugs. And then quality of life, where FDA really recognized the quality of life as a very important endpoint, because it really shows the symptomatic improvement of patients, and it's really an important point when evaluating the approval of drugs. So progression-free survival is most commonly used endpoints for patients in advanced disease. There are several advantages of using progression-free survival. It needs less patients than overall survival. It does not is not influenced by post-progression treatment, because patients or events are counted at the moment when the patient has a progression. They are not affected by crossover and can be valid in certain types of cancers, and can also the same importance translated to the overall survival. But the challenge about progression is that it's measured by certain criteria, and now in solid tumors we do use RECIST 1.1, but it's arbitrary. And we know, for those of us who work in clinical trials, when you have central versus local radiology review, there are many discrepancies, inter-observer variations. So it's sometimes arbitrary. Very often, even if there is an increase in size, there still can be a clinical benefit to the patients. And again, in many trials, it is allowed to continue treatment even if a patient has a clear progression. And then, of course, again, in immunomodulating drugs, the tumor flare is absolutely not a progression. And it should not be confounded, and patients should not be actually discontinued. So it's really important to know how and when to use this progression-free survival as a primary endpoint. But again, drug development is a long and a painful process. It can go to 10 or even 15 years in some cases. So it's obvious that different approaches from the regulatory point of view, but also from clinical trial design point of view, are needed. We know that EMEA is a little bit behind FDA in the timelines that they approve drugs, about 6 months. So here on this line, I just want to point, for example, that on average, it's double the time. And I'm here, okay. So you can see here the timelines for erlotinib were 111 days by FDA and 390 days by EMEA, or maybe sorafenib 350 days by EMEA and 166 days in the FDA. So here is just an overview of different processes that are used by FDA and by EMEA to actually approve the drugs, because the regulatory bodies on both sides of ocean recognize that drug approval process is really important. It has to be relatively quick, but obviously with certain prerequisites from the sponsor's point of view. So if I just go a little bit about breakthrough therapy from US, which offers the sponsors very early communication and collaboration by the FDA in a guidance. However, they have to show some preliminary data that the drug is really working, so some positive preliminary data. And then while the trial is running, they can have guidance by the FDA. In Europe, here, as this is a European Congress, there are several approaches by EMEA, which is accelerated assessment, conditional approval, and I would like to just touch a little bit about priority medicines, because it's very actually new. It is launched only 2 months ago, on March 2016 of this 2016, and it's actually a kind of a pendant to FDA breakthrough, because obviously because of the majority of drugs being fastly approved in the FDA, the EMEA timelines need to be speed up. So this priority medicine approach, or PRIME, has been now put in place, and it's really European EMEA approach to give fast track approval for drugs that for patients with unmet medical need and for novel compounds. But of course, it's very important to have a good design. So it means to understand the disease, to understand the stage, to see what is most appropriate for that disease and stage of patients in their treatment. But it's obviously extremely important to have correctly found patients to most benefit from the treatment. And just one of, I think, unfortunate stories that we are all aware, and just to bring it a little bit as part of this talk, is this definitive approval that actually got accelerated approval by FDA in for patients in third line, based on two phase two trials with a good response and a duration of 7 months. But when FDA required the sponsor actually to run a confirmatory phase three trial, which they did on a very big sample size of However, the overall survival was not statistically significant. There was some improvement in time to treatment failure. And it was not really clear what was the reason behind, and it actually had some dramatic effects on removing the label and definitely not very not good effects for the drug approval. So basically, retrospective analysis were able to prove, because there were only 1/3 of patients who had available tissue samples, and only a smaller number of patients had actually the needed gene copy numbers and gene expression and gene mutations who could have responded to gefitinib treatment. So actually, maybe more of the most of these patients who were treated, even if they had a high gene copy and high gene expression, but were not treated with gefitinib, it is known that they do worse. So that's why it's really important to have the right patients treated with the right drug. And on next few slides, I just want to have some examples to see, to present how this personalized treatment is really important. And this is a publication from JCO, and probably Professor Hermond might recognize as well, where patients, 33,000 patients went through this meta-analysis and pooled analysis from single-arm studies about in 500 trials, where actually personalized treatment came statistically significant as independent factor for a response rate, median progression-free survival, and median overall survival. So all patients in for solid tumors and hematological malignancies. And not going into the details, it just proves actually that we have to find the right patients for the right drug. The example of crizotinib, which is really one of the most probably best examples, in fact, of a very approached and directed drug development, where only 8 years have passed from the first patient who, with ALK rearrangement that were treated with crizotinib until the fast approval based on two phase two trials that had response rates of 50% and 60%. And then a phase three confirmatory registrational trial that screened 4,000 patients, but only 350 who had actually the ALK rearrangement have been randomized, and where progression-free, I'm sorry, where progression-free survival has been was statistically significant and led to crizotinib approval. Just to note that overall survival was not significant, but this was probably due to crossover of patients, and this is something that I already covered a little bit, what the crossover, how it can actually influence the overall survival results. So moving forward a little bit, if this works, and it works, is how we have to really modify the clinical trial design, because we know that we had this static clinical trial designs where patients have to meet all the eligibility criteria before they can be randomized, and it takes quite a long time to be able to come to a good result. So obviously, it's changing because research is changing, the treatment is changing, we have personalized medicine, we have immunomodulating drugs, so the clinical trial design must change. So just a few words about adaptive clinical design. There can be, and I'm, as I said, not a statistician, however, I will try to a little bit explain a little what it is, adaptive clinical design. So it's really actually accumulating data, using the data that accumulate during the trial run to modify the trial, either maybe to stop one treatment or to readjust the sample size without actually protocol amendments. And here are some examples of these adaptive clinical trial designs. For example, biomarker enrichment that is using biomarkers, or umbrella or basket trials umbrella, where actually patients with a certain tumor type and with a certain biomarker can be exposed in testing different drugs that actually target this molecular pathway. Or, for example, basket trials where patients with different histologies but having the same biomarker or same common molecular dislocation, they can be treated with the same drug. And as I said, adaptive clinical design, and this is the definition from the Pharmaceutical Research and Manufacturers of America, but FDA and EMEA have similar definitions where actually data that are accumulated during the trial design are used to modify that design, or as FDA and EMEA say, they're using pre-planned interim analysis to actually modify the trial design. And here again, just to show how different adaptive clinical designs are used. The advantage is, of course, that they can have an overarching, there can be several trials running actually at the same time. They have higher chances of success. They have a decrease in costs. There are no protocol amendments, and we know how protocol amendments can be painful and can cost a lot of time before they get implemented. There are some limitations because they need very thorough planning in advance, so a lot of collaboration between clinicians, scientists, and good statistics. Sometimes they are difficult to interpret, so it's really an experienced team is absolutely necessary. Data monitoring committees who follow these trials and evaluate the endpoints and the results. And of course, from the statistical point of view, it's quite complex statistics, but that's going beyond this call. And now the last couple of slides will be just examples of some of the basket trials. This is the first example, is the custom trial. It's a trial that has been published last year in the JCO, which was designed actually to treat patients from non-small cells, from small cell cancer and from thymic malignancies, who have different molecular rearrangements and to be treated with their corresponding targeted drug. So patients who had, for example, EGFR mutations were treated with erlotinib. Patients who had RBB2 rearrangements were treated with lapatinib. Selumetinib was, SMAC inhibitor was used to for those patients who had RAS and RAF mutations, and also ALK inhibitor MK226. So basically what it was, all these patients from different histologies but harboring actually the same molecular rearrangements have been in a non-randomized way put in to be treated with a drug that actually matched their molecular rearrangement. So the aim was really as a kind of a proof of concept to see that even with smaller number of patients, positive results can be used or arms can be closed if actually a small number of rearrangements have been seen and patients could not actually match the treatment. So for example, then erlotinib arm only entered 15 patients and was closed because there was a lot of supporting data from other trials, of course, with erlotinib and recognizing actually which patients have to be treated. And this is really a proof of concept of what a basket trial can be. And here on this slide, just to show that how the survival curves were showing depending on the patients which were treated. So A were patients with ALK rearrangements, E standard for EGFR, K was for KRAS, A was for other, and these were patients who had either no mutations or insufficient material. Of course, there were some minor disadvantages of this trial, a smaller number of sites, some laboratory issues with obtaining the tissue samples, and that actually influenced the accrual, but it was more really a proof of principle how to do the clinical trial, how to organize and to design the trial, and to have actually treating a smaller number of patients for to prove that a certain drug is efficacious in the certain patient population that is harboring that are harboring same molecular pathways. The different example and a different tumor type is a prostate cancer. It's the STAMPEDE trial, which actually is also a multi-arm, multi-stage study that started with six arms and through several stages. The first stage was really to evaluate the safety of the compounds, and then it went to the stage where events were counted for time to treatment failure, and then the final stage for the survival advantages. And in the meantime, two arms, which were using celecoxib were closed because there was absolutely no advantage, so it was not ethical anymore to treat these patients. So finally, after 8 years of treatment and 43 months of follow-up, docetaxel plus androgen deprivation therapy became obvious that it is the superior arm, and also shown on the subpopulation of metastatic patients. So now this is in the guidelines for ESMO and NCCN, because in parallel or together with STAMPEDE, the CHARTED trial and the CTUG-15. So based on results from these three randomized trials, docetaxel ADT is now the standard of arm, standard of should be considered for patients who are hormone sensitive and fit to be treated with chemotherapy. And then the final example for patients with breast cancer in the neoadjuvant setting, the I-SPY 2 platform, which actually has started from I-SPY 1, I-SPY 2, and it's now I-SPY 3. So it is really adaptive trial design, which actually tested and included genomics and proteomics to test actually the drugs that can lead to pathological complete response and to identify certain compounds from the early stages and to bring them to the later stages, so to have some kind of qualification of graduate drugs. And drugs that were tested had to have some prerequisites from their phase one data, so that they had safety and efficacy results, and that they also have some efficacy results in combination with taxanes in breast cancer population. So these patients had multiple MRIs to evaluate the pathological complete response, but also had biosamples, had tissue samples to evaluate biomarkers. And of course, there were two candidates of drugs who have moved in a later stage of development. That was veliparib together for triple negative breast cancer, and also for neratinib for patients who were hormone receptor negative and HER2 positive. So these were examples, of course, how actually the statistics, the clinical trial design have to follow the clinical research and medical discoveries, to have shorter timelines, to have more flexible clinical trial designs, to be less time consuming, less costly, but actually to bring good drugs shorter to the patient. So of course, this personalized medicine is an absolute probably future on how patients will be treated, but they are complex. They are not so easy to be implemented in everyday work and in clinical design. So obviously a very tight collaboration between statisticians, regulatory bodies, and clinicians is needed really to have this approached in a correct way. So thank you. Thank you.